so many great black films that year. Boomerang came out that year, and that shit had everybody hot in 1992. Almost nobody was excluded.
Yeah, Boomerang was, and it was
Hall was in there.
It was a drama, a comedic drama, maybe you would call it.
Mm-hmm.
So, I believe those genre of films were around that time were popular also.
Mm-hmm.
Creating films that were had kind of a humor to it, but they're also dramas.
What about Eddie Murphy? Made him so much more than a black actor. Question A. And then B, what made his movie so damn good? Because Boomerang, you can watch it today, and it's still entertaining. It keeps its pace. The cinematography is a little bit old, but it still is, like, warm in a way where, like, he had a way of making you become a part of his films when you're watching it. Like, you just sink into the story. And it was that way. Even with bullshit like The Golden Boy. I remember that
shit. The Golden Child?
The Golden Child, whatever the fuck it's called. I recall really enjoying them. And, like, Beverly Hills Cop, he was able to flip a switch and go all kinds of ways with what he was doing.
Yeah, but those were 80s movies, and those were a little bit different than Boomerang, I think. Boomerang was a softer type of movie that was like, you hadn't seen black... To be honest with you, before then, you hadn't seen a whole lot of movies about black people having relationships with each other. Like, can you think of a lot of movies where it shows, because in that movie, it shows how black men have relationships with other black men, like friends, and how they have relationships with black women. Can you really think of a movie before the 90s where you've seen a black cast and they had intimate
Cooley
relationships?
High and shit like that.
But those movies were set
in like
school times.
But not these are grown like, brotherhood.
Yeah, these are like grown men who will meet you on Friday at the pool hall type of thing. And then we'll talk about women. And then it'll show our relationship with women. How we treat women. How women treat us.
In a more human capacity, because there was consequences and, like, real feelings.
What do you possibly think you know about love? You know, I'm sick and tired of men using love like it's some kind of disease you just catch. Love should have brought your ass home last night.
Didn't you just hear me say I was sorry?
I heard you say you're sorry. You're sorry and you're tired. You don't love me. You don't love Jacqueline. You only love your damn self.
I think Boomerang itself, the film itself, should have had a bigger impact. And I think it stands the test of time for black films, because it was like almost no discrimination in the movie as far as who they casted. Just think about it. It had Eartha Kitt in there. It had Grace Jones in there. It had Halle Berry. Halle Berry was like the new, like, young, light-skinned type of female that was like...
The new Eartha Kitt, damn near.
Yeah, there was like, she was like the, what we consider, what, you know, I'm talking about the audience, what they consider as black and beautiful at that time, like coming up, the new one coming up. But you still had Eartha Kitt from back in the day who was the beautiful one.
They let her play Catwoman and everything.
Exactly. So I
think... She was super light skinned though. I barely knew she was black as a kid watching that.
Yeah, but I mean, Halle Berry's is similar. But then they had Grace Jones. They just threw it all the way on the other side.
Right, like, and that's Grace's alternative rock, like, wild as fuck.
And then you had
shout out Grace Jones.
You had all the male actors that wasn't necessarily, like, I wouldn't say Eddie Murphy was like a sex symbol back then, but he was like.
He was smooth as fuck in that movie.
Yeah, and then what's the other girl that Man, there was somebody else in that movie.
Robin Givens was in that movie.
I'm not a Robin Givens fan, but...
Yo, wait. Hold on.
I don't rock with Robin Givens, bro.
Came up here to talk to you about us. I'm rapping. This is my Mac Daddy vibe I'm giving you. In all of its splendor. What's up? This
oh, really?
Yes. I'm the Alleganza Mac Daddy of the month.
Oh, I see. Well, let me get a good look.
Check it. It's like Jet Magazine. What's up?
You are absolutely wonderful. But I think that we should kind of make this clear right from the start so there's no misunderstanding. You see, I don't date men I work with.
Well, then I quit.
You can't quit because I need you.
What happened? Well, Mike Tyson ruined her whole career, her life.
No, she ruined her career by chasing after Mike Tyson.
What? Okay, break it down. Because I feel, I was thinking about this yesterday, and I almost felt, well, because she's trying to sue Mike Tyson, and she's stalling the production of the new Mike Tyson biopic.
Right.
I bet, though, okay, if Mike Tyson has control of a narrative, literally the darkest part of his existence was her. So if I make a movie about my life, that would be the one that I would, that time frame would be the one where I would try to reflect as bad as on Robin or give as much of the other side that people didn't see as possible. But so where does the chase break it down? I was young.
Yeah. Mike was at a point where the stories were already out how Mike was. And of course, things probably got progressively worse when he started getting more and more money.
Mm-hmm.
But it wasn't like the whole world didn't know. Like Mike even says it to this day, I was an animal. Like I was an animal. He's not only a fighter, but he used to get in fights outside the ring. He's been locked up before and been in juvie and all that type of stuff. My question to you is, okay. Somebody like Robin Givens who looked like her, would she get with somebody like Mike Tyson if he had that same record of being locked up in juvie and all that
and
being aggressive
rich?
And had a regular job? Would she get with him?
Probably.
With a regular job?
Man, I mean, bugging. Look, if she wasn't Robin, like, obviously, like, as, like, because they tried to portray her as, I think they fucked up because people looked at her and thought she was, just like with Whitney Houston, they find these black girls and they're like, oh, they're proper, they're acceptable. And then they still like
hood dudes.
Just the same.
But the difference between her and Whitney is Whitney was getting bread already. Robin Givens, her fame really came from Mike Tyson.
For real?
Yeah.
Do men gotta do successful
nobody was putting her on the pedestal
so
before that?
Hard. She's bad. In Boomerang, she's literally the finest one on that movie.
I don't know about that, but I don't really rock with Robin Givens. From what I see, and I'm not even saying what she's saying is not true about Tyson.
And she spoke up, and her whole trajectory.
She can't.
Landslide of snow hit her ass.
What was her talent? Was she a great actress?
Don't ask me trick.
Exactly. So I don't know if her.
There's a lot of people who weren't great but had.
She made an aura and a charisma.
She
made her career spending Mike Tyson's money. That's what she did. That's what she made her career.
Okay. But she was a supermodel.
I guess. But it doesn't matter. It don't matter at the end of the day.
They were both famous when they met.
I don't know how famous she was. Nobody was talking about Robin Givens like that. Mike Tyson was the biggest thing on earth.
How am I okay. Oh, well, okay. So was he with her when Boomerang came out? I don't think so. I think that was after. Ooh, probably really.
Yeah.
Because what was the span of Mike Tyson's hot streak? It was not long at all. That nigga was like a flying comic.
No, his hot streak was long. I don't remember. I don't know the exact information, so I don't want to say it on camera.
You is right. Like the Evander Holyfield fight, I was grown. I was like not grown, but old enough to understand shit. That was like 96.
Yeah, that started to get, he started to get in murky water then. But prior to that, he was,
I mean, Mike, he went to jail over Robin Givens.
Yeah. No, he went to jail over Desiree Washington.
Oh my God.
And she was the one that was like Miss America or something. She was in a pageant and that's how he met her. So I'm telling you, Mike, I'm telling you, Robin Givens was one of those, she came off as one of those girls that was only with Mike because he had bread and he had fame. She don't strike me as somebody who had that type of dude. And matter of fact, if we look, I want to see some more dudes that
well,
she's been
started,
with.
Well, she started, no, Mike. I feel like she dated some extra corny. That's how he got. That's how she got in the movie Boomerang, though.
No,
is what
no,
you're saying?
No, she had a little bit. She already had. She was established.
She wasn't famous.
Was she? She was from
she
a TV show
like
initially,
wasn't
she?
But she was able to get into certain doors based off of her who she was up and coming to be. Mike Tyson was the type of dude. He would be at your local club in New York kicking it. So it would be anywhere, but it would be world news. So Robin Givens, it wouldn't be hard for her to find out Mike Tyson's going to be at a certain club to go there and.
You feel like she literally hunted him down. And
yeah,
the level of fame.
A lot of women did.
I don't think he understands the level of fame that Mike Tyson had.
Right.
This dude was. I'm not talking about. He was global before we had prior to the internet. Prior to social media, he was already global. Like they knew him in Japan, and he lost when he lost his fight. He lost in Japan. He was fighting in Japan. Yeah. This dude, Mike Tyson, was a different type. He already, by the time he met her, he already had a video game after his name. That was unusual for a boxer to have his own video game.
How do you know she was aware?
Just know that in 1992, I was older. I was probably 16 or something.
Uh-huh.
I was old enough to know.
And y'all felt that
Mike
way watching
Tyson
it all
a,
happen.
He was from a different, he was famous like, he was, Mike Tyson was Mike Tyson, Michael Jackson, Michael Jordan.
Yeah.
That's what kind of famous he was. So what was your thoughts about Boomerang as a movie as far as like, what was your thoughts about it? Like, is it something you could watch now and you'd be entertained
by? I said that, yeah.
Okay.
I would watch it now. I highly recommend it. If you ain't seen Boomerang and you miss a good Eddie Murphy movie, don't sleep on it. Don't let the 1920s feel of it. I think that turned me off to it for so long. And then I was like, oh, this is a regular movie.
Yeah, and it also had Chris Rock in there briefly.
Mm-hmm.
It had Martin Lawrence in there, so it had other comedians in there.
Arsenio Hall.
Yeah.
We could go on and on.
Had a lot of people in there.
Everybody.
Yes. Chris Rock was in there. He was the one in the house that said, first the Fat Boys break up. And
And that's where Jay-Z got that line from.
Yeah, that's where Jay-Z got the line from.
First the Fat Boys break up.
And
now
this,
every day I wake up,
and
he
this
got
is
a
the,
problem with me.
First the Fat Boys break up, now this.
This is the thing about that from a technical standpoint, a movie standpoint.
Mm-hmm.
When Chris Rock said, first the Fat Boys break up, he's upstairs. It looks like he's on like this upstairs looking down. And the mics are not close to him. So when you hear it, there's a reason why there's no close-up in that movie. They show it from a far away, the angle of the camera, the distance from the camera is far away. And Chris Rock said because that wasn't part of the script. He just said that in the movie, and they decided to keep it because it was a cool line. And then that becomes one of Jay-Z's lines, which is like serendipitous a little bit, you know? That it becomes part of the hip-hop... zeitgeist or ethos or whatever, it becomes part of that. Have you seen Class Act?
Nope.
Okay. 1992, Class Act. You now, to give it some kind of context, you're coming off of House Party. Kid and Play is still a thing. Class Act is one of the movies they're in. They kind of were doing their thing.
They were in a movie but it took place in school.
Yeah,
instead of a house.
Yeah, so they were in House Party. They had some success. Martin Lawrence was also in House Party. That was prior. Class Act comes out with starring Kid and Play. So you have them, people still listening to their music at that time. And but they were making a transition into movies.
And there it was, the one mistake that would change the rest of my life.
Because they could have been the next, they could have been a Will Smith duo had they played there.
Yeah, one of them found religion. And then, you know, Kid, I want to say Kid is like Jewish. Kid is Jewish.
The music industry is Jewish, so that's never not a way. No, you know, Drake is Jewish.
Yeah, but I'm just saying, I'm saying they kind of made an exit from music, trying to, it seemed like going to film. It didn't go too far, but they did have a little run, and this was part of that run. They didn't have a whole lot of films, but this is one that I thought was funny, and it was like, it was one of those goofy films. You don't really like have like super high expectations of it. I mean, it looks like a bunch of grown kids in school is what it looks like. Kids that ain't really 18 that maybe flunked a couple times are still in school. Like some of the people in the film were like, he's still in school? So, yeah. But it was kind of funny. Play was the, of course, the tough guy. And then Kid was the light-skinned one, was the, he was more of the nerd. But everybody thought that they were opposites. They thought that Kid was the tough guy because
Play was like the more lead of it.
No, they both were in the lead. It was a tag team duo type of thing. And it was similar to anything else they were involved in, including their music. It was like they were evenly starring in that in Class Act. But it was one of those things that was kind of funny, and people would like repeat the
quotes from it.
Hang with you. You back me up, I'll back you up. Sure, I guess. Damn. Watch out, move out the way. Move, the man's coming through. Move. One side. Get out the way. Yo, move. Pave the way for the king. Pave the way for my man.
Yo, Blake, why don't this time you give me your number?
You want my number? I don't have any paper.
That's fine. Just put it right here.
It wasn't like a movie you would say, man, let's go to the movies and watch this or watch this again. Like, I don't know if I rewatched it today, if I would, you know, have... I would
the
probably,
same feeling?
Yeah. Like, it was just a goofy kind of film, you know? But it was coming off the House Party
wave.
Vibe, the wave. Yeah, they just rode that wave and let's shoot something of
it
kids
wasn't
in school.
Any more mature or anything?
No, it was like... It was like 21 Jump Street or 22 Jump Street. Did you see the remake of that or not? It was similar to that. Like, even the storyline was kind of not exactly the same, but it was kind of that thing. Like, there was a thing for these high school films, you know what I mean? Like, let's shoot people in high school, and it was just one of those goofy type of films. But I you know... It was funny, though, at the time. I just don't know if I watched it now would I laugh, you know?
Right.
Yeah.
And then, so South Central, let's get into that.
South Central, you never seen South Central?
I didn't say that. I just asked your opinion first.
But have you seen
it? Yeah.
Okay.
Now, it was like a serious street drama.
Yeah, it was, you know, okay, so you had... Street, even that one would have some stereotypical stuff in there. Mm-hmm. Like, that was just like over the top.
Extra,
like,
yeah. Well, because it's trying to be a drama. They're not trying to...
Any of y'all know Jimmy Johnson?
Hey, man, you better have an invite walking on this turn.
Listen up, man. I'm OG Bobby Johnson.
You're Killer Bobby Johnson?
You J-Rock Daddy?
That's right. J-Rock broke out of jail last night, and I'm looking for him, and I need some help.
Sure you ride. You gonna ride down on Willie Manchester?
Of course I am, but I need J-Rock. You know where he at?
He at Rary's storehouse on Crenshaw and Hope Street.
Cool.
Hey, OG Bobby Johnson, you need help killing Willie Manchester? You just call.
Yeah, you hear a lot of quotes from that, and it was really not a great movie, but it was something at that time that was reflective of the type of movies that were the type of low budget street type of films that would come out at that time. Especially talking about gangs, because I think people don't realize, like, people think of Chicago as being
and
really
it did
bad.
Explain gang, yeah.
Yeah, they think about, and it explains the transition from being a child to being part of a gang also. I think...
Which was very important.
Right.
Because that gets missed to so many people.
Right. And people think about Chicago as being this, like, horrible place right now. But back then, Chicago was worse. When you're talking about the early 90s, and you look at the numbers of murders, like...
Guess what? That's because they tore down them projects and built them condos.
Yeah, I mean, it was...
And sent them to Bloomington.
You start looking at those numbers, and you'll see like 550 murders for Chicago. A few years ago, you'll see like 550, 600, and you'll think that's a lot. But you look at the early 90s, you start seeing 900 murders in a year. You know, so...
900.
It was a different time, and gangs was a big deal then. Gangs was a big deal.
That was like, oh yeah. Like now it's interesting the degression of like the colors and the repping. But back then niggas was really like
it was
you
serious.
Couldn't tell them shit about that gang.
You couldn't you had to if you was wearing your hat a certain way or if you was wearing a certain color. You would have to explain that mm-hmm. to somebody.
Where you from, cuz?
Yeah.
Where you from?
Yeah, you would need to explain that. So, gangs was a little more structured then, but there was still like the Wild West and people was getting murdered. Now you have where people are kind of like the gang is like, it's almost like a fad. Like everybody's in the gang. You can just wake up and
I would say like 2000s. There is. Okay, yes, there is like the, and people are creating their own gangs mm-hmm. and then like calling it like rap group, there's all kinds of shit.
Yeah, so South Central was just.
But, and there's rap group, gang, like OTF, I don't, that's right. Some, like whatever the fuck that is.
Yeah, I mean, you always had cliques or whatever that would give themselves a name. A lot of people identified with it, and it did fit the context of the time. I just think it was there was a lot of stereotypes in there, and it went kind of overboard. There wasn't any intelligent black people in there, really. There was the redeeming, like, I go to jail and redeem myself and become a new man. You did see that, which is a...
You don't... What is you doing?
Yeah.
You don't want to be going down this road. I've been there.
I got it. You got parole.
I got parole.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
You got your second chance. Don't blow it, brother.
I won't blow it.
Are you a deuce?
No, I am not.
Can you stand alone like a man has to?
Yes.
Go find your boy. Save his life.
I'll do it. If it takes my life, I'll do it.
I believe you, Bobby.
Yeah, you get that, and you get the that guy who played in there. He plays that role multiple times where he's redeeming himself or he's in prison. But you don't get the real like intelligent black person. You don't get that in that movie. It's kind of like a bit stereotypical, to be honest, you know.
Thank God somebody for your first time.
What?
Not trying to tiptoe.
Nah, I just try to explain it in a way where I think it gives people the context.
It's funny. It's almost like you got to overdrive. There's a fine line between being stereotypical and overdriving the point. Mm-hmm. Sometimes to get certain people to understand things, you have to overblow it to put it into context for them. It's crazy how many times I'll think I understood something until I seen it in overblown terms. And when it comes to like expressing gang culture, and when you have a message like this, and like trying to make people who aren't aware know this is going on and help the people who are going through it, you can be desperate to get your message out.
Yeah, or you can be, you can try so hard to entertain people.
At the same time.
You'll start making these characters, or these, you'll turn them into caricatures, or you'll have these archetypes, like the guy who goes to jail and gets out and becomes a new person, and he tries to stop his son from making
going
the same
down
mistakes.
The same. Even yeah. And that's so played out. Even power turned into.
Yeah, I think it's the storyline that's going to be with us forever. But I just think you can add things in there. Like, it doesn't have to be. Because
they do it in a way where it almost covers it up on power, but it's still the same old shit.
He's spitting a lot of negative at me about Deuce, loco. What's up?
Ray Ray don't share a dime with no motherfucker on the set. He got himself a new car for Ray Ray. New house for Ray Ray. He got all the new sets out selling his crap. Yeah. He even got them little wannabes out working.
Exactly. So if... I mean, if you can do that, then we'll. Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, we can do that tomorrow.
Yeah, but I think there's a real life component to that. And that's the reason why you hear that story a lot, or people use that archetype. But I think at the end of the day, when you look at that film, it was obviously a low budget film, and people didn't have a problem with low budget films then, because you have to keep in the context, like, bootlegging was big, like mm-hmm. on the street, like you could buy films on the street that are bootlegged, you know? So you had some low budget films like that, and maybe they just didn't have enough help.
It rose above.
Yeah, yeah. Because there were things
we're talking
in the movies
about it in 2020. Yo, you know what my favorite film of that year was? Ooh, there's so many. It's another good year. I'm shocked. I'm just waiting to find a year and tear it apart. I think we need to stop looking so good for films and all that shit.
We need to get off the even numbers. I think the odd numbers is where the trash films are.
Yeah, but, yo, Juice.
Juice.
Juice with Tupac. Man, that's a hell of a movie.
1992.
It didn't have a long story or an elaborate story, but the story was so, like, the actors, I don't know what about it, but it was so intense. I remember seeing it for the first time and just being consumed and, like, just, but every Tupac performance was like that. Really emotional, really riveting, edge of the seat type stuff.
Tupac, I'll go out on a limb right now. Tupac is the best actor rapper.
Yeah. Like, straight up.
Yeah, I can't think of somebody, even if you go through LL, Ice-T, none of them, even Queen Latifah, none of them act better than Tupac.
Well, and it was just the passion, the tone, and even you could never really get over his intensity because he got better at it. And it was one of the rare cases where his intensity in the music translated so well to movies. He literally carried these films so well, you thought the other actors were better and the story was better until you're like, you know what? Tupac just had me on the edge of the seat. Like, Bishop was just extra as fuck.
What's up? I ain't seen in a couple days. What's been happening? Man, get off that shit. It's over. It ain't nothing nobody can do about it, man.
What do you want from me, man?
Nothing. Just came to see if you was all right.
I mean, a lot of his characters were just intense, and even if they were the same person. But he almost played the same character, which was typically a good guy in first appearance who went to the other side.
We did see him play another role in, what was it with Janet Jackson?
Poetic Justice.
Poetic Justice showed a different side of him. But I
will
say,
it was almost a reverse of that role, where he started off as the ignorant one.
Right.
And grew.
Right. If you listen to his music, though, and you kind of match it with the roles he played, it was almost like the people who casted him were fans of his music.
Mm-hmm.
It almost felt that way, like, we did this part specifically for him.
Right.
Yeah.
Like, we want Tupac the rapper
right
in our movie. Yeah, well, and especially once they saw how good of an actor he was.
Right.
It's funny, I saw an interview around that time in About Juice, and they were like, how do you feel? Because you sit here and talk about thug life and all these changes. Because he was political back then,
mm-hmm.
And had a lot to say about things in that nature. And so it was almost contradictory for him to play the roles that he played in the movies he played, because there was so much black-on-black violence. And he gave a great response. And that was, how else are black people going to get a chance to act? At least it's a black script. People will be able to see black people through and through in these films. It's crazy. I heard somebody say racism is the Democrats' best lie. But, like, if we're still facing that much scrutiny in 1992 and it's that hard for black people to get through a certain door, that even he consciously knowing that these movies are detrimental.
Right.
But, like, positive in the long term because it opens up a new door. That shit is sad.
Pac's whole, his whole entry into acting is interesting because they caught him at a time where he hadn't become so West Coast. If you think about it.
And Juice, it was a New York-ass movie. Through and Juice through. Breakdancing, DJing.
It's all New York. And Pac hadn't become a staple on the West Coast yet. So it was like something that maybe wasn't a stretch for him to act in. Because if you think about his life, he lived in Baltimore. He lived in New York. He lived in Oakland. He lived in L.A. He lived in multiple places. So he's adaptable in a way that a lot of people aren't. Above the Rim was not West Coast, though. Above the Rim was New York, too.
Damn.
That was
they
like
loved, even Gang Related was a super New York-ass movie.
I just think a lot of movies were being shot in New York at that time.
Right.
Like people was in love with that culture. But yeah,
cause it dominated hip hop.
Yeah, that was before. That was before.
Dr. Dre couldn't even stop the East Coast then.
Yeah, that was prior to him like making his allegiance to the West so much.
Did Tupac make the East Coast whack?
Stop.
What
kind of question is that?
How is that a bad? Wait, hold on. You can sit here and play like New York holds the same relevance now that it did then, but it don't. And it shifted during the East Coast, West Coast beef almost. There was something, and even the South found room to get involved.
Okay. But in 1992, you started to see a shift. And
ooh.
Tupac didn't have an immediate impact on them, but he did later on.
Okay.
But yeah, there was an album that, to me, started the shift to go towards more West Coast music.
So yeah. I asked a good question.
You think you asked a good question.
Oh, God.
But yeah, only thing I'll say about Juice was dope. And it's like we didn't get a lot of movies as black people, I don't believe. Like when you start looking at the amount of movies that are put out, we didn't get a lot, so we kind of make those classics. Like, that movie, the editing in that movie is terrible.
You
like,
think
the edits,
so?
The edits are horrible. Yeah, I mean, even if you look at just the way the movie was shot, period, it's not nothing that you're going to be like, man.
That's revolutionary.
Yeah,
right?
Like the framing
that
of the movie.
That's sad.
Yeah.
Well, and even, yeah, it's like, it sucks that they have to categorize shit like most successful black people.
Right.
Like, and especially when automatically that means it's a lower bar. You know, getting the prize at the bottom of the Cracker Jack box.
Right. I think the truth about it is that they have lower budgets for movies that have big black casts like that.
Mm-hmm.
Like mostly black casts.
Woo! But they get, and see, I feel like maybe 1992 was a shift for a lot of things, because there's a couple diverse black movies to throw into that boat. I feel like they still have very similar flaws. Actually, there's hella great black movies that came out in 1992. Tupac, You Lied. You should have got a fucking role in Malcolm X or Boomerang or any of them other movies. Yo, 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 it's Brandon Daz, Daz Exotic, whatever you want to call it. Subscribe to our YouTube, link below. Yo, time flies, so.
Time flies. Time flies.